Well, let's stand. We're going to read Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 to 14. We're running the last leg of our relay, so to speak, Intense Christianity. This is our last lesson. I don't think we'll finish everything tonight. I doubt it. But this is the last lesson. We're going to read responsively our text, Philippians 3, 1 to 14. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Just to say that while we were teaching and touching on this verse, we made mention of the fact that for most of us, suffering the loss of all things is a hypothetical situation. But Paul said, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Before I suffered the loss of all things, I counted them but loss. Now that I have actually suffered the loss of all things, I count them but dung. So, Paul was saying, I have not only contemplated the loss of all things and count them nothing, but having suffered the loss of all things, I have come to count them as worse than nothing. And be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. Righteousness which is of God by faith. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You may be seated. I would like us to bear in mind that in Philippians chapter 3, Paul is giving us his spiritual biography. Now, when he decided to write this letter to the Philippians, he didn't set out to do all of these things. But as he wrote, the Spirit of the Lord led him to share these things with the Philippians, to open his heart to them, as it were. In verses 1 to 7, he speaks of his past. In verses 8 to 16, he speaks about his present. And in the closing verses of the chapter, which we will not be considering in this series, he speaks about his future. In verses 1 to 7, we become acquainted with Paul, the accountant. In verses 8 to 16, we become acquainted with Paul, the athlete, which is what we'll be studying tonight, Paul, the athlete. When we looked at Paul, the accountant, we saw him setting some things in the credit column and some things in the debit column. And if we were to look at the verses which close the chapter, we would become acquainted with Paul, the alien, living as a stranger in this present world. But we won't be considering Paul, the alien. In lesson 6 of our study, we looked at, and I just want to pause here to welcome the persons who are following us on live stream. We want to just thank you for your encouraging comments, and we are happy that these lessons are being a blessing to you. In lesson 6 of our study, we considered verses 9 to 11 of our text. And we look at an expanded translation of those verses by Kenneth Weiss, which is almost a literal translation from the Greek. Yes, in order that I might, in the observation of others, be discovered by them to be in him, not having as my righteousness that righteousness which is of the law, but that righteousness which is through faith in Christ, that righteousness which is from God on the basis of faith. And on Sunday, a lady came to me and she said to me, "You know, sir, I am just understanding what righteousness is. I thought it was something that I achieved on my own." And she said, "I am so happy now." That brought tears to my eyes. She's been in the church so long. "Yes, for his sake, I have been caused to forfeit all things, and I count them but dung, in order that I might come to know him in an experiential way, and to come to know experientially the power of his resurrection, and a joint participation in his sufferings, being brought to the place where my life will radiate a likeness to his death, if by any means I might arrive at the goal, namely the out-resurrection from among those who are dead. We noted that Paul expressed in these verses the desire to so come to know his Lord, experience the power of his resurrection operating in his life, and a joint participation in his sufferings, that he would be brought to the place where he would become, both as to his inner heart life and also as to the outward expression of his inner heart life, like his Lord, with respect to his death to self. So, when we read Philippians chapter 2 from verses 5 to verse 11, where the Bible says that our Lord was in the form of God, the word form there is a philosophical term. It's not a material term. We have to dismiss from our minds any physical, corporeal image. It's a philosophical term. The word form is translated from a Greek word which means that which gives expression to the inner nature and character of a being and is associated with the inner nature and character of the being and can be no different from the being that it is expressing. And so Paul is using that word here, and he's saying, and the same word is used when it says he took upon him the form of a servant. It means that Jesus was not acting like a servant. In his heart, he was a servant. He wasn't just like some great actor on the stage. He was a servant inside. And what you saw when he stooped to wash his disciples' feet was not an act to show how humble he was. It was an expression of what he was on the inside. And many times in my own life, I realized that what is coming on the outside might not really be expressive of what is on the inside. It could just be an act. But Paul is saying here, I want to be brought to a place where my inner heart life and the outward expression of that inner heart life reflects that I am dead to self, just as Jesus in his humanity came to a place where he died to self. Brethren, when I contemplate these things, I am not able to deal any longer with the nursery Christianity. I am depressed by it. Right now I feel so burdened, you know. I don't know what it is this evening. I feel heavy. We noted in that same lesson 6, that our Lord's death to self was illustrated in his self-emptying. In Philippians 2:7, the Bible says he made himself of no reputation. The Greek word is kenosis. He emptied himself. As I have said before, when we look at the incarnation standing from earth and looking up, we say God became a man. He was incarnated. But when the angels stay from heaven and look at it, they say he emptied himself. He emptied himself. This self-emptying was true of our Lord, not just in his act of becoming incarnate and of stooping to the death of the cross. That is how God became a man. He had to empty himself to become a man. But also that which conditioned his entire earthly life and made it the beautiful life that it was. So what we are saying is that when he became a man, yet he emptied himself. Because you see, we are men, but we are so filled with ourselves that sometimes we think we are gods and act that way. But even when he became a man, he didn't act that way. It's a great rebuke to all of us who sometimes allow pride to get control of us. Great rebuke. This double humbling that Jesus went through. For him to become a man, the best way I can put it is for me to become a dog. But of course it is far more drastic. There is more similarity between me and a dog than God and a man. But now, as a man, to humble yourself from knowing from where you have come from, to brethren, it's difficult for us as men and women, even being in the church for a little while, it would be difficult for us to tolerate somebody spitting in our faces without responding. But here was the one who made them taking it. And here we are, so filled with pride. What a shame. Paul says, see, this is what I'm reaching for. While you, the Judaizers, are reaching for circumcision, I'm past that stage. This was a death to self. A denying of self for the blessing of others. It was this radical conformity to the spirit and character of the life of Jesus Christ that Paul was striving for. He had progressed far beyond a mere legalistic observation of rules. He was grappling with the intense Christianity that is a byproduct of an intimate relationship with Christ. He's feeling the pull of the relationship. It's taking him into waters that he never dreamed of at first. it's pulling him into a vast area. He's seeing the beauty of holiness. He's contemplating the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And he's reaching for it. And it is mesmerizing him. He now has lost sight of everything else. I was singing a song to myself the other day and had to stop singing it, you know. We preach like the apostles and we teach like the apostles and the word of the apostles we obey. We baptize like the apostles, heal the sick like the apostles, and we follow the apostles all the way. And I was saying, well, some of it is true, but not all of it is true. How many want an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ? Is there a longing in your heart for Jesus? Not for what Jesus can do for you, but just for Jesus. Every one of us desires to be an overcoming Christian, but there is a price that must be paid. We must be willing to grapple with the intense Christianity that Paul spoke about in verses 9 to 11. Let's listen to them again. This is the message now. I didn't want some petty, inferior brand of righteousness that comes from keeping a list of rules, when I could get the robust kind that comes from trusting Christ, God's righteousness. I gave up all that inferior stuff so I could know Christ personally, experience his resurrection power, be a partner in his suffering, and go all the way with him to death itself. And of course, we're not talking now about physical death. If there was any way to get in on the resurrection from the dead, I wanted to do it. What are the essentials for engaging successfully in the process of intense Christianity, winning the Christian race, and one day receiving the prize? There are at least five of them. Dissatisfaction, devotion, direction, determination, discipline. Let's read them again. Dissatisfaction, devotion, direction, determination, discipline. We will consider each of these essentials briefly. So dissatisfaction. In verse 12, Paul writes, "Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Not as though I had already attained." This is the statement of a great Christian who never permitted himself to be satisfied with his spiritual attainments. Obviously, Paul was satisfied with Jesus Christ. but he was not satisfied with his Christian life. A sanctified dissatisfaction is the first essential to progress in the Christian race. If you are contented with where you are, there will be no drive to go further. And if you think that you have attained where you are now, maybe you are not even saved. The Philippian saints probably considered Paul to be a spiritual giant. But Paul did not see himself in that light. He wanted them to know that as far as he was concerned, he had not yet attained the goal stated in verse 10. He was still actively pressing on toward them. He had by no means reached the final stage of his sanctification. Paul's salvation experience had taken place about 30 years before he wrote to the Philippians. He had won many spiritual battles in that time. He had grown much in those years, but he confessed that he was not satisfied. He still had more spiritual heights to climb. There is not one person in here, and I say it without apology, who has done as much for the Lord as Paul. And if he could say, "I have not attained," not one of us in here can say, "I have attained." Are we satisfied with where we are spiritually? Do we think that we are completely sanctified? Paul's dissatisfaction should serve as a warning to us that there must never be a stalemate in our spiritual growth or a height beyond which we cannot climb. In the words, "not as though I had already attained," Paul is saying that he has not yet fully appropriated the four things he mentioned in verse 10. In some measure, he has been discovered by men to be in Christ by the very life he was living. In some measure. He had come to experience, in some degree at least, the power of God surging through his being. He had entered into a joint participation with Christ in suffering for righteousness' sake. The stoning at Lystra, recorded in Acts 14:6-19, was an example of that. He had been brought to the place in his experience where he radiates to some degree the death to self, the self-denial of the Lord Jesus. But he had not laid hold upon these completely. He was not experiencing them in the fullest measure. There was room for much improvement and advance in these respects in his life. If this was true about Paul, then surely it is true about us. You know, I'm wondering at this. I'm wondering at it, you know, brethren. Wondering at it. Wondering at it. Wondering at it. Because, you know, Paul had said that, you know, "I'm not ready to be bound. I'm ready to die. He had said that. He said, don't even try to stop me from going to Jerusalem by telling me that the Holy Ghost is saying, if I go there, I'm going to be bound. Paul said, I'm not ready just to be bound. I'm ready to die. Yet, after saying that he's writing this, not as though I had already attained. Many of us couldn't sincerely make that statement. I'm ready to be bound. Not only ready to be bound, but I'm ready to die. We wouldn't venture that far. But yet we feel like we have attained. There's a great lack of hunger for Jesus in the church. We are too easily satisfied. We set the bar, the measurement of our Christianity so low. We think that by doing things, we are there. So low. And I, you know, brethren, I realize that it is not easy to stir people. Martin Luther King Jr. said in a speech exactly 1 year before he was assassinated, he says, the human spirit does not move except with great difficulty against all the apathy of conformist thought that is in one's own bosom or in the surrounding world. You know, the conformist thought that tells us this is Christianity. We have become so accustomed and acclimatized to it that it's difficult for us to push beyond it and see that there's a whole different world out there in a relationship with Jesus. Sister Jackie, I was tempted to ask you when you gave that testimony earlier of the little girl who spoke to the policeman and said, which church do you go to? I was tempted to ask you, which church does the little girl go to? But I'm scared to ask you. Many Christians are self-satisfied because they compare their running with that of other Christians, usually those who are not making much progress. Had Paul compared himself with others, he may have been tempted to be proud and perhaps to relax. After all, there were not too many believers in Paul's day who had experienced all that he had. But Paul did not compare himself with others. He compared himself with Jesus Christ. And when he did so, he found himself sadly lacking. He wrote to the Corinthians and told them, if we compare ourselves among ourselves, we are not wise. But we enjoy doing that. Because, you see, it's comforting for me to know that Sister Tanisha is not where I am. So as long as I can focus on her and keep my eyes off Jesus, I'm all right. when I start to look at Jesus and look at myself, then I'm in serious trouble. Brethren, I want to ask us all to resist the temptation to compare ourselves with others. Don't compare Pentecostal Tabernacle with other churches. Resist the temptation to do that. Don't compare one organization with another organization. Let's try and compare ourselves with Jesus and see how we match up. Let's try and compare our organizations that we belong to the first century church and see how we match up. Let's look at the miracles that occurred in the first century church and see how we match up. See, where I stand, brethren, there is such a great distance between Jesus Christ and myself. Such a great distance. Such a gap. I have a longing to sit under the ministry of someone who will take me closer to Jesus. I want a ministry that will, as the writer of the Hebrews says, move me away from the principles of the doctrine. He said, not laying again. Surely we don't have to go back to repentance and the baptisms and the laying on of hands. Surely we don't have to continue keep saying that every Sunday. Then he says, I'm not made perfect. Either we're already perfect. The Greek word, now just follow me. This is a little, can become a little technical. I need for you to follow me. He says, the Greek word translated perfect does not mean sinless or without fault. The word means spiritually mature. Now watch this carefully. Spiritually mature, that's what we're dealing with. The tense is the perfect in the Greek. So Paul is saying that he has not come to the place in his Christian life where growth in spiritual maturity has been completed, beyond which there is no room for further development. And that as a result, he is now in a state of absolute spiritual maturity. Paul says, I'm not there yet. I have not come to a place where my spiritual maturity is of such a nature that I cannot improve. I'm not at that place. Can you concur with that, brethren? Are you at a place where yours cannot be improved upon? Or is there room for improvement in your life? Paul is not saying I'm not spiritually mature, you know. He's saying, even though I am mature, I'm not. There's a lot of room for improvement. Now, at verse 15 is important. Can we find verse 15, please? It's an interesting verse because it seems to contradict what Paul just said. Philippians chapter 3, verse 15. In it, what does Paul say? Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. So he's just saying in verse 12, I am not perfect. But in verse 15, he's saying, let us who are perfect be thus minded. So we could be confused. So let's try and clear that up. Interestingly, Paul uses the word perfect in verse 15 also. In verse 12, he says that he's not perfect. But in verse 15, he says that he is. Is Paul confused? 1,000 times, no. In verse 12, Paul is speaking of a finished process, an absolute spiritual maturity beyond which there is no room for improvement. Whereas in verse 15, he's speaking of relative spiritual maturity where there is room for development and growth. So, let me try to explain it to you. I have a son here. He is in fourth form at Excelsior. But this morning, he sat his math exam in CXC. Now, really, that's normally done when you are in fifth form. So he sat it today. Now, it is my hope that he is perfectly ready for CXC math. But he's not yet ready for CAPE math, you see. But at the stage where he is, he's perfectly ready. But there is room for improvement. Because if he's going to do math at university, he has to progress. But at the state where he is now, he's all right. You understand that, folks? So let us look at a baby that was born today. Would you expect that baby to be sitting up now? Huh? Would you expect that? No. Would you expect the baby to be sitting up after 1 month? Some of you are not sure. Look like you have a baby that is a freak. About 6 months, eh? So now, if the baby is not sitting up after 1 week, would you be concerned? And say, the baby not perfect? No. Because the baby is perfect for where he or she is right now. But you know that there's room for improvement. There's room for growth. So if after a year the baby not sitting up, you know something is wrong. But right now, the baby is perfect. The question is, am I perfect for the stage where I'm at? It is very doubtful, almost impossible to expect the person who was saved 2 weeks ago to have reached the spiritual maturity of Sister Annette. But that person may be perfect for their stage. And it could well be too that they are more ready for the coming of the Lord in their little 2 weeks than I am in my 30 years. Because I might be a spiritual retard. after 30 years. Still not potty trained. Now, if the 2 weeks old person is not potty trained in the spirit, we can work with that. That person might still mess up themselves. But we are expecting that as we grow older, we learn to sit down on the seat and do our own paperwork. Right? Eh? And clean up our own little messy. And then we pull the chain. Chain day is gone now, man. You know, still pulling chain. You know, say yes. You know, pull chain. We press a button. Or maybe you are there with automatic. As you get up, everything is absorbed. And you see, folks, we have to not only reach at a stage, but we have to keep there. And we'll come to that later on in the study. I think I might have shared this with you before. It sounds humorous. I was walking, when I used to live in Havendale, I was walking. And I met a friend of mine. He's some years older than me, but we used to work closely. You know, we used to work closely when I was working at an insurance company. And he was always a very witty fellow. You know, very quick, and his mind worked very good. I'll give you an example. He once saw a bald-headed man that worked in the office, and he said to me, "Mr. B, he has a good brain, you know." And I said, "Why you say that?" He said, "Grass never grow on a busy street." So, you know, he was a person with that. So when I encountered him, I asked him about a friend that we used to know, and he said, "Sir B, disaster take him, you know." So I said, "How you mean?" He said, "He married a fourth wife, you know. And this fourth wife was an attorney. And she divorced him. And take away everything he had." He said to me, "Sir B, you ever see a sponge go over like a puddle of water? And when you take it up, you don't see nothing? Is that happened to him? She absorbed everything he had." So I said, "But how?" Because he was a man of substance. And he said to me, "Sir B, you ever hear the saying, heights of great men reach and kept?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Some man reach but cannot kept." He said, "Slowly take him like a tire." Brethren, we have to be careful that we reach and cannot kept. Slow leak. You know some of the leaks that can occur in spiritual life. Brethren, have you ever known of any person that in your living for the Lord, you have looked up to this person, and they might even have been a mentor for you, but somewhere down the line they lost their way? Have you ever seen that happen? Did you ever think it cannot happen to you? Always remember now, if people come to you and say what a blessing you are to them and how they look up to you, always remember that the head of the idol might be of gold, but every idol have feet of clay. Tell yourself, it's clay feet I have. Head might be gold, you know, you might have brilliant mind, but is the feet do they walk in? In verse 15, Paul exhorts the Philippian saints who are spiritually mature to consider themselves to be so only in a relative sense, and to remember that there is much room for spiritual growth in their lives. The spiritual maturity spoken of in verse 15 is not a state of sinlessness or flawlessness, but one of completeness of a well-rounded Christian character, a state opposite to spiritual infancy. In verse 15, Paul is stating that he is indeed a spiritually mature Christian. In verse 12, he explains that he is not satisfied with his level of spiritual maturity. It is important for us to understand that one mark of spiritual maturity is the knowledge that one is not perfect. The mature Christian honestly evaluates himself and strives to do better. And folks, there's no way, we will never come upon a point in our lives when we look at Jesus and look at ourselves and don't see some discrepancy. And sometimes the closer you get to Jesus is the more terrible you look. That is the mystery of the whole thing. We would have thought that the closer we get to Jesus is the better we would look. Repeatedly, I have mentioned to us of Paul's self-evaluation, eh? Remember? 1 Corinthians 15, he says, I am the least of the apostles. Now that was a humble statement. For he didn't say, I'm the greatest of the apostles, you know. Although, in that same passage, he said, I work harder than all of them. He did say that. Paul said that. I worked harder than all of them. Paul had some tough things to say, you know. Paul says, only me and Barnabas that can't walk about with a wife like Peter and the others. Everywhere they go, they carry their wife, but poor me, you have nobody to carry. But he said, I'm the least of the apostles. But then in Ephesians, he said, I, who am less than the least of all saints. So he didn't say, I am the least of the saints. See how far he's coming from? Least of the apostles, you know. Now he says, I am not the least of the saints, but less than the least of all the saints. And as I have said in his final summation, he said, this is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am, not was, I am chief. What happened to you, Paul? You're backsliding? No, getting closer to the light. And when the fullness of the light shines on me, oh, spots all over that I didn't see when I was in the distance. When I was over here, the light wasn't shining on me so brightly, so the shirt looked white. But when I get close to the light, spots everywhere, holes everywhere, dysfunctional everywhere, fixing up as I go along. I have to make a little check here, brethren, because self-evaluation can be dangerous. We can err in two ways. Most of us err in one of the ways. We may consider ourselves better than we really are, or we may consider ourselves worse than we really are. I meet with both kinds of people almost on a daily basis. Often in the Bible, we are warned against a false estimate of our spiritual condition. In Revelation 3:1, our Lord said the following to the church at Sardis: I know all the things you do, and that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. So they thought they were better than they were. Anybody in here, you think you are alive, but the Lord's estimate of you is that you're dead? Well, you wouldn't even know you because you think you are alive. Until the Lord wrote that to the church, they didn't know. They thought they were a wonderful church. They had reputation without reality. Is that so with me, Pastor Bartlett? Reputation, but no reality. Members of the church board, could it be so with you? Sunday school teachers, choir members, could it be so? Reputation, but no reality. Ministry directors, could it be so? Church at Laodicea boasted that it was rich, possessed everything it wanted, and did not need anything, when in God's sight it was wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. This is the reality, you know. The church, this was an apostolic church that existed in the first century that thought it was all right. And Jesus said, you don't even know. The thing about it is, he said, I wish at least you could see yourself. I wish at least you could say, yes, I know I'm a dog. But you think you're a lion? In contrast to the Laodicean church, the believers at Smyrna thought they were poor when they were really rich. Revelation 2:9. Samson thought he still had his old power, but in reality, it had departed from him. You want to stand up and try, shake yourself and see if you still have your old power. Sad if you have to shake yourself, eh? Paul did not consider himself to have reached a state where he was free from sin. He's not saying here that no one was perfect or that no one could be in this life, but he's declaring that he did not regard himself as having attained to it. The Judaizers thought that they were perfect. Paul had no illusions about himself. He says, I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. He had to follow after, pressing forward in order to lay hold of that for which Christ laid hold of him. Again, we say that a divine dissatisfaction is essential for spiritual progress. It is one of the hallmarks of intense Christianity. One of the things I look for is the desire to be like Jesus. Desire to be like Jesus. I am attracted to people who have a strong desire to be like Jesus. There was something for which Paul was striving. which he had not obtained. After years of walking with the Lord, there were still things wanting to render his character and condition complete, or what he desired they might ultimately be. There was still a struggle for the crown of perfection, a crown which the apostle says he had not yet obtained. Do you feel that struggle in your own life, brethren? Just lift your hands and worship Jesus. Feel that yearning and that struggle. Want it. Just want to be like Jesus. So bad. So bad. The words follow after are from a Greek word meaning to pursue. I follow after. This is why we say we are becoming acquainted with Paul the athlete now. He has in mind the image of a Greek runner streaking down the race course. He's pressing on toward a fixed goal. The word is in the present tense, signifying a repeated action. Paul is literally saying, I keep on striving. Keep on striving. The word apprehend is from a Greek word which means attained, but with a preposition prefix which means down. Paul wants to catch hold of Jesus Christ. And in catching hold of Jesus, he wants to catch hold of all of his will concerning him. Pull him and his will down and make him and it his own. It's like a rugby player or an American football player who not only wants to catch his man, but wants to pull him down and make him his own. Paul wants to appropriate and make his own Jesus Christ and that for which Christ called Paul and made him his own. This is what Paul is talking about in the expression being made conformable unto his death. It was Christ-likeness that Paul was pursuing. It is absolute Christ-likeness that he says that he has not yet captured and pulled down so as to make it his own. Paul wanted to ensure that he secured Jesus Christ and all of Christ's will and purpose for his life so completely that there would be no possibility of him losing Christ for all of time and eternity. Want to pull him down and make him my own. Can you imagine that? My son Matthew, he used to play rugby, you know. I tried to discourage him. I said, I never play rugby in school. I play cricket and football. Play a little cricket and football, and I'm on rugby. But he just loves everything rough he loves. But you can imagine what Paul is saying. In a sense, what he's saying, you know, is that I'm running after Jesus and his will for my life. I'm running after him. I want to tackle him and bring him down. I say, where you going? I hold you now. You're not leaving me again. You belong to me now. What a thing that would be, brethren. What an appropriation. When we talk about intense Christianity, when I talk about it, that's what I mean. Would you believe, brethren, I'm speaking the truth in God, I lie not. I'm the pastor of this church. I've been the pastor of this church. The 4th of July would be 11 years. And I don't... I'm not sure this is what God finally has for me. I am really pursuing, you know, because I think there is more. I don't know if this is the final stop. I don't know if this is the purpose for which I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. I'm following after. Can you imagine Paul starting churches all over the world and say, I'm following after. I still don't know the full reason that you got hold of me. Is there more? I feel like there is more. One of the time Paul said, I have to go to Rome. Whensoever I shall take my journey into Spain. There's still a restlessness in me. Want more. More. I want to be sure. I want to tackle Jesus and bring him down. Just because I can't take a big drop now, why I don't put it in practice, just run and tackle a man and pull him down, you know. Because, you see, I'm just thinking, maybe if I tackle him, he might get up and I can't get up. New Living Translation renders verse 12 as follows. I don't mean to say that I have already achieved these things or that I have already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. The message says, I'm not saying that I have done this altogether, that I have it made, but I am well on my way, reaching out for Christ, who has so wondrously reached out for me. Let's turn to Acts. Let's go to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 9, eh? Paul and the Damascus Road. Verse 6 says, and he trembling and astonished said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? That was a question Paul asked of Jesus. And 30 years later, it's the same thing. What do you want me to do? He's not saying, I start holy for churches. I do this, I do that. So I'm all right. No, saying, what you want me to do? What wilt thou have me to do? Verse 10 says, and there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth, and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. And for I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Paul said, I want to know. Following after, pursuing, I still want to know. Is this it? Is this what you were talking about? I want to be sure. I don't want to miss anything. Paul said, fill up the sufferings of Christ in me. That's what he wrote. Devotion. We're going to touch on this and stop. At the beginning of verse 13, Paul restates what he said in the previous verse. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. See how much times he said? Not as though I had already attained. And now he says, I count not myself to have apprehended. The word count is from a Greek word which occurs often in a commercial context, meaning to calculate. It is a favorite term of Paul. And is often used in the sense of carefully weighing the point under consideration. It has the force of looking back upon the process of a discussion and calmly drawing a conclusion. Paul had, after much deliberation and consideration, arrived at the conclusion that he had not yet achieved absolute and complete spiritual maturity. It is evident that some of the Philippian saints had arrived at the opposite conclusion regarding themselves. For Paul uses the personal pronoun in the Greek in connection with the verb count. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. I. He does so for emphasis and to show contrast. He says literally, brothers, I for my part, or I myself, do not count myself to have grasped. He was saying, not like some of you that think you reach. I know I have not reached. Just touch yourself and say, I know. I know. I know I have not reached. I know. Now Paul proceeds with a forceful statement. But this one thing I do. In this phrase, the word this and the words I do, if you look in your Bible, you see that they are in italics. They were not in the original Greek. But they were supplied by the translators. And they are not needed. The words are not needed. What Paul literally says is, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing. One thing. One thing. One thing. One thing. One thing. One thing is a phrase that is of supreme importance to the Christian life. You see, this sums up the entire Christian conduct and purpose of Paul's life. One thing thou lackest. One thing thou lackest, said Jesus to the self-righteous rich young ruler. We looked at that last week. To the overworked Martha, when she criticized her sister Mary, he said, one thing is needful. The blind man whose sight was restored in John 9 said, one thing I know. David said, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after. Paul said, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing. Too many Christians are careful and troubled about many things, when the secret of progress in spiritual maturity is to concentrate on one thing. One thing. Saint of God must devote himself or herself to running the Christian race. No athlete succeeds by doing everything. He or she succeeds by specializing. See, all of the Usain Bolt fans, watch Justin Gatlin. The World Games in Beijing might turn out different from what you hope. That man, see, Gatlin, in his mind, is one thing. Remember that I told you this tonight, you know. So when a man says one thing, even if I'm getting help, and I don't know if I'm getting help, I'm not saying he's getting help, you know. And you see, when you point at another man and say, I'm getting help, make sure you're not getting help too, you know. Because the other thing with we Jamaicans, we just believe we do everything right and everybody else cheating. But it's we alone not cheating. I don't know much about the thing, but Brother Colum will tell you sometimes if a trainer know that them going to test him horse, him just pull him from the race and say my horse the four legs sore. Him can't run today. And then just pump him with diuretics and he flush out everything in the urine. So all over the world is what trainers do. If them know them athlete, if them suspect anything, them just say hamstring, him can't run today. Him out for a year. Some of you don't know how the thing works. But you see, when somebody say one thing, I'm not saying it must be so, you know. But I'm saying, don't be surprised. I hope it is not so. But I have a lot of admiration for a person who is just dedicated, you know. I have a lot of admiration for people like that. There are a few athletes who seem proficient in many sports, but they are the exception. The winners are those who focus and concentrate on one discipline, keep their eyes on the goal and allow nothing to distract them. They are devoted entirely to their calling, like Nehemiah did in Nehemiah 6:3. They reply to the distracting invitations, "I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down." James 1:8, we are advised that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Focus and concentration are the secrets of power. If a river is allowed to overflow its banks, the area around it becomes a swamp. But if that river is dammed and controlled, it becomes a source of power. It is wholly a matter of values and priorities, living for that which matters most. See, folks, I hope you are seeing. I hope you are seeing that when I spoke about righteousness, about being the righteousness of God, and when I spoke about salvation being a matter of grace, I know that there were people who thought I was saying, okay, so we just can't live any way we want. But you can very well see that if you are engaged in intense Christianity, you are called to a higher standard than any organization can ever set. No preacher can give you rules to live like this. You have to make up your own rules. No pastor can tell you what to do if you're living like this. You've gone into a realm now where you're looking in Jesus' face and he's saying to you, this I want you to do. I know the church program. I'm asking you to do this. You in relationship with me. No man who lives like this can do what they want. In fact, this man or this woman is open for God to say to them, bake some cakes with dung and eat it. Lie down on your side for a certain period of time. Go and take a wife that is a prostitute and marry to her. No church can't not telling you that. In fact, the church will tell you, don't do that. Premarital counseling will tell you, don't do that. But God said, do that. You're not hearing me. So why are you so quiet? Is it a lie I'm telling? No. Okay. God is sovereign in the church. Talking about relationship. Yes, it might be a good general rule for most people, but God is saying, come, this is what I want you to do to manifest my glory in your life. Because I'm in relationship with you. But what we want to do is make sure that we tick all the boxes. And then we say, yes, I'm all right now. You're not all right. You're not all right. The rich young ruler ticked all the boxes. Paul Paul had one great aim and purpose of life. This was the secret of his extraordinary success in Christian life and ministry. But one thing. I count not myself to have apprehended, but one thing. I know I don't reach there yet, but one thing. I know I have a long way to go, but one thing. I know I've made some mistakes along the way, but one thing. Can't beat a one thing, man. Person will accomplish little if he or she allows their mind to be distracted by a multiplicity of objects. A Christian will accomplish little if he or she does not have a single great aim and purpose of soul. That purpose should be to secure the prize and to renounce everything that would be in the way to its attainment. This is intense Christianity. It is the only type of Christianity that will ensure that we apprehend that for which we are apprehended of Christ Jesus. If Paul had ever lived his life based on what the legalists in Jerusalem wanted, there would never be a church in Asia. Or if there was, it would have been corrupted. Paul said, there's no way I'm going to start a Jerusalem church in Europe. You know how many Jamaican churches you have in the United States? And Canada and England? It's not English churches you have, it's Jamaican churches. I watch it everywhere I go. It's not like I go a whole heap of places, you know. But everywhere I go, you know, and some of the pastors have trouble because the saints say, that is not how my bishop from Jamaica do it. Well, come back and stay under your bishop in Jamaica, no man. Who tell you to leave? No, stay under your bishop. You're in a different culture. Certain people not coming to your church if all you can sing is, burn them! Burn them with the Holy Ghost. But you expect to attract certain people in your church. The only people you're going to attract is burn them people. Oh man, to attract some people, I might have to start singing Abide With Me. What was the song the children were singing during the praise and worship there? It sounds so nice, but it slipped me now. Oh, it go again. Na 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 na. Somebody raise it for me now, man. For the Bible tells me so, little ones to him belong, are weak, but he is strong. So my question is now, what's sinful about that? It's not your style. So, we're not catering to your style. Whatever we can use to win and disciple people, to make them become like Jesus, That is the style we're after, the Jesus style. Not the Bondem style. We better learn that out here if we want to see certain people in our church too. This is, for some of us, this thing about the whole gospel to the whole world is just a saying. We don't mean it. Just a saying. But Paul said, I have to go into the deep and listen to a different voice. Paul said, when I go up to Jerusalem, those that were of importance never add nothing to me. Because what I heard it downloaded from the man himself in the Arabian desert. I never had no communication with the apostles. God, take me away in the desert. And for 3 years, him download the thing in my system. So when I come out with something for the Gentiles. Don't force me to fit into your mold. That's what he's saying. Because I have a mission to win the Gentiles. Let's stand and worship Jesus. Jesus, 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 all I really want is you. More about Jesus would I know, more of his grace to others show. More of his saving fullness, more of his love would I. More. More. Who died more about Jesus? Let me learn. That's where we are now. Spirit of God. Sing it. More about Jesus. Oh, yes, more. Sing more. Yes, more of His love who died for me. More about Jesus. Yes, holding communion. With my Lord, hearing His voice in every line, making each faithful say, tell me more, Jesus, my Lord. Yes, more of His love. Sing more about Jesus on His throne, riches in glory. His own, more of His kingdom show, increase, more of His coming, pray. Tell me more, Jesus, my Lord. Oh, yes. More of His saving fullness, more of His love. I feel like giving an altar call for the saints. More above. Anybody want to just come to the altar and spend 5 minutes? Talk to Jesus about more. Not more of Pentecostal tabernacle. Not more of the movement. More of Jesus. Not more of Pastor Bartlett. More about Jesus. Yes, more about Jesus. Oh, yes, more. Find Him. Find Jesus. That's who we want to find. Jesus, not men. Jesus we want. More of His love. One last time. My Lord, more of His saving fullness, more of His love, who died. Let's take a few minutes and just seek His face now. Amen. Lift your hands and worship the Lord tonight, brethren. Yes. Jesus, you are the one that I love. You are the one I really am striving for. You are the one I'm going after. Tired of titles and positions and politics and drama and playing by my rules and trying to do it by myself. And no, I'm wanting your righteousness now. Want to do it your way. Bless your brethren. You may return to your seats for a little while. Thank you for responding. Thank you very much for responding. Thank you. All the members of Zone 4, you are being asked to meet on the choir loft for a brief but very important meeting immediately after Bible study tonight. Pastoral assistants and ministry directors, remember we have a prayer meeting tomorrow at 6. We have our Labor Day project on Saturday. Brethren, we are coming here at 7 to do some work. Please. Okay, not the entire Zone 4, just Spanish Town and Central Village. Those members who live in Spanish Town and Central Village. Now, brethren, please listen to me carefully. Ushers, would you just come, please? Some of the ushers, just come and stand up here. We're not going to hold the Lord's people for much longer. Brethren, on Sunday we have a rally. It starts at 8:30 with prayer. Like for us all to come, pray. And in the evening, listen now, in the evening we're going to have a service. And on Sunday night, our children ministered, and Brother Dean Taylor brought the message, and the Lord filled 5 children with the Holy Ghost, and it just came into my mind for Sunday night, I'd like to reach out for all our children and teenagers who don't have the Holy Ghost. It can be sometimes too, brethren, that we evangelize on the outside and don't evangelize on the inside. There are some of our children and young people who don't have the Holy Ghost. So we're going to have just a Holy Ghost clinic on Sunday night for our children and teenagers. So I'd like everybody to come, all our altar workers. Let's see all our children filled with the Holy Ghost and baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. Let Pentecost come for the children too. All right, folks. Amen. Sister Heather has a special announcement.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Okay, it's in relation to our Labor Day project, right? We are in need of persons to come and volunteer. We are asking that if it is that you may not want to assist with the building of the wall, but you may want to come and help with us cleaning the sanctuary. There's a classroom at the high school for the 12-year-old class that needs painting. So we need volunteers in those areas. We also need persons who are willing to work in the garden as well. So what we're going to ask you to do, Sister Diane, Brother Nolte, if you are here, can you just stand, please, as I call your names? Sister Diane Barrett, Brother Nolte is at the back. Brother Nicholson, is he here? Sister Rosalie Sawyers, not here. But we're asking you, Brother Nolte is to the back, and here is Sister Diane. Just give your names to these persons before you leave, because we really, really need your help, and Sister Heather and myself. Amen. So please come out. We need more persons to come and work. And also we need you to bring whatever equipment you may have. If it's cutlass, rakes, brooms, you know, buckets. If you have a vacuum, we need you to come and bring those items as well.
There are other items we are needing. Gloves, spray bottles, dust masks, chamois. Buckets, at least two more. We have gotten some already. At least one push broom. We need some yard brooms, about six. Mops, one cobweb broom. That's the tall one. Eye places, please. We need disinfectant, bleach, two 100 feet hose, some vinegar, 5 pounds of baking soda. And is there anyone who has access to a power machine that can assist in washing off the walls of the church? Please speak to me. Now, as it comes to the food, people are coming, and we want to give them something. And we need your assistance. So I'm asking if I can get 10 persons to stand who can give me one whole chicken. Quickly, people. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I need two more.
Ten to bring one.
All right. So you're bringing one chicken each. It's 2 work days, so whichever one you can bring. But we'd like for you to carry the chicken by tomorrow or Friday. Please speak to Sister Ruth. I will speak further to her about it. I need 6 tins of corned beef. No, sir, I want them to stand because I want to know that I get in the 6 tin. All of it, miss? Okay, yes, okay. Thank you very much. Now remember, it's 7 a.m. sharp. We are working. We want to cut it as close to 11:30. We know we might go over, so we want everybody to come out early so all of us get to go home early. All right? That's how we're working it. Thanks much.
One more thing, persons who you may have a barrel at home, whether it's plastic or the regular cardboard, we're asking you to take it. Sister Barbara Scarlett is in need of it for the clothes bank. So if you have any barrels at home that you're not using, please to take it as well. Amen?
Just bring your whole supplies, brethren, for you don't know what we might want. Everything you have that is needed, just bring it. Amen, everybody? Let's all stand. Now, brethren, on Sunday evening, next Sunday, not this Sunday, next Sunday, a very amazing thing has happened. One of our children's home. Which one is it again, Sister Renee? National Children's Home. This doesn't usually happen. They have sent to ask us to come and have a service. We usually ask them if we can come. So they have said, can you please come and have a service next Sunday? Can you imagine that? People want the help of the church, you know, folks. So it is 5th Sunday. But we are asking all those who are able to go, and we'll say more about it on Sunday. Please, we have to make a sacrifice. Because this door might not be open forever. And we are talking about intense Christianity. And na 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 na. And this is all part of na 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 na. It's true, you know, brethren. All right. We are going to pray, and then, brethren, I'm going to ask you to give a special offering. If each of us could give even $500, try and see what is the best you can do. I'm serious. We have needs that we need to meet. And sometimes we just can't talk about some things. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for all that you have done. Dismiss us now with your choicest blessings. Bless the offering that will be received. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Come with your offering, folks. Go on the choir loft to meet with the persons from Spanish Town and Central Village. Brother Frey, could I see you?